clap this morning. Y'all keep it meaty.
Say bye. Congregation, can you lift your voice? Sing it with me.
And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your grace unending.
You have the right idea. Let's clap it out.
So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Bless the Lord, His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. Worship the holy name.
Will you please join me in the call to worship? How great is His joy in the victories you give.
You have granted His heart's desire and have not withheld the request of His lips.
You came to greet Him with rich blessings and placed a crown of gold on His head.
He asked you for life and you gave it to Him, length of days forever and ever.
He exalted in your strength, O Lord.
We will sing and praise your might.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Certainly this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. I'm glad to see y'all this week. I missed y'all last week, but I'm glad to see that we are still up and running. I did watch our service from the wonderful, wonderful, wonderful country of Mexico. Chas and I went to Tulum last week, and the food was meh, but the vibes were great. And so while we were on that beach, I had our wonderful service pulled up just to show you, you can still go to church on vacation. So I know some of y'all have some vacations coming up. Don't worry. You can still go to church on vacation. I like to be demonstrative of everything I ask you to do, and so I won't ask you to do something that I won't. So you can be in your bikinis or your Speedos, whatever you desire. This is a no judgment zone. This is the Lord's house, so we can't judge. So I'm just glad to be back with y'all today. There's a lot of new faces in here today. I know it's spring break, so spring break has brought us some wonderful families. And if you ever are looking to move to Texas, we have a wonderful church that you can join us here. So at this time, I just want us to get up out of our seats, go to a few people, just tell them you are glad to see them today. You're glad to see them today.
Thank you.
find your seats. That would be wonderful. I know I turned you loose, but I gotta reel you back in.
Good morning.
Good morning. Again. Certainly glad to be in God's house one more time to praise his holy name. I'm so grateful to see all of y'all here. I know we have some few things to celebrate. Matt and Sandra were married a couple weeks ago. So glad they are here. Children, are we expecting? Okay. You know, it's never too late, you know. I know you're right. If God can touch Sarah, he can touch your bones too. Oh Lord. Don't make me do. Don't make me do. Yeah, I know I'm Pentecostal, so what I'm doing is just make me shout. I'm gonna shout for you, you know what I'm saying? Alright, cut it out. Cause we'll go, we'll do it. Okay, also, I am so excited. Y'all know we've been searching for an associate pastor for like 10 years. And I haven't even been here 10 years, but we've been searching for 10 years. And it was a very, very, very great process, but also very rigorous, because I believe in bringing the best before y'all as well as our executive team. And so I'm glad to announce that we have selected an associate pastor who is joining us today on the first day, Sebastian Aguilo. I'm gonna invite you up here so everybody can look at you. Come on up. Yeah. You know, I believe in putting people on the spot. That's just, that's the right thing to do. And so I'm grateful for Sebastian for being here. We're gonna celebrate him in a couple of weeks when we officially install him here as our associate pastor. But I just wanna give him the opportunity just to greet y'all, say hello, and all the other good fun stuff.
Well, as he said, it was a very rigorous process, a lot of tears and prayers, but I'm happy to be here with every single one of you. I'm happy with what God has in store for this church and its people. And I'm just very glad to be part of Casa View Christian Church. So I wanna thank you all of you as well. Amen.
All right, so I'm excited for our future, looking ahead of what God's gonna do with us in the next couple of months. Just excited for what God has planned. I'm putting, again, Sebastian on the spot. Sebastian is bilingual, just in case y'all were wondering. And for the ladies who were here last week, I'm so glad, when he preached last time, I'm glad that you didn't pass out, you know, because, you know, some of y'all were a little hot and bothered, but don't worry. He's a part of us. He's family now. You can't date family. Okay? You can't do it. I mean, you could, but it would be very, very frowned upon. So grateful for him. And maybe in a couple of weeks, we will give y'all a sermon, and he'll be able to translate it in Spanish for our Spanish-speaking people. I think that'll be fun. So that's forthcoming. I'll send you the manuscript in advance. All right, well, that's all I have. I know we have so many prayer requests today. I've been a part of our prayer chat group, and I know we want to lift up those who are certainly needing the prayers. I know one I wanted to highlight, Sharon's granddaughter had emergency surgery for an internal bleed. Is that correct?
Yes, they found a liter of blood in her stomach.
My Lord.
And a cyst in her ovary.
Okay. So that's certainly we want to lift up Sharon and her family and her granddaughter during these times. I just believe that scripture tells us that the prayers of the righteous, they avail us much, which means when we put our faith together, God can do anything. So we want to lift up Sharon and her granddaughter and all of the other prayer requests that we have today. I know there are many that we have, but we want to just continue just to be dutiful and prayerful saints, because if the saints don't pray, it's a sad time. All right. Also, to my left by the gather signs, y'all know what today is, right? Palm Sunday. All right, that was a test. This is probably the second most important week of our Christian faith. The first one, of course, being when Jesus was born. All right. This one is when Jesus dies, and everything in between we're grateful for as well. But this is the start of our Passion Week, or Holy Week as termed in some faith traditions, where we get to recognize Jesus coming back into Jerusalem for our behalf. And so for the next selection that our worship team will sing, there are some palms in the back. Diane and Deanne, can y'all pass out palms? And everybody gets palms. Hopefully there is enough. If there isn't, and you are a couple, just share together, all right? You're gonna share everything in life and in palms today, all right? And then also, Diane also has a form for us. We are putting together an online directory. And so with this online directory, we wanna make sure that we have your current contact information. This directory will also be available to all church members. And so if there's some information that you don't want displayed, such as like your home address or phone number or email address, you can indicate that on the form where you don't want shared with the general public, right? But we also need all of that information as a church group, okay? So you can give us the information and then you can say, I don't want X, Y, and Z shared with everybody else. Does that make sense? All right, perfect. So she's gonna pass that out shortly after the palms are passed out. Some of the palms are a little bit thinner than the others. Some of them palms been eating real good. All right. I mean, really good. What's that? Texas waiting on the palms. All right. Everybody got a palm? All right, perfect. So on our next selection, after our pastoral prayer, I want you to wave those palms as long as you can. Some might can do it for 2 seconds. Some of y'all might do it the whole rest of the service. It doesn't matter to me. You know, wave those palms, wave them in the air like you just don't care. All right. All right. Well, while she's passing, I'm going to wait till she finishes passing those out because I like to pray when we all have our attention on Jesus. While we're waiting, I have a joke to tell. It's funny to me, maybe not to y'all. How did the butcher introduce his wife? He said, meat patty. Thank you, thank you. You'll get that on the way home. It's so bad, but yet it's so good. All right. All right.
That's a bad dad joke.
It's and I love bad dad jokes. Yeah. I love that. I love those. All right. Well, if there's nothing else, let's join our hearts in prayer. Dear Lord, we certainly thank and praise you today. For certainly this is the day that you've made and our hearts are positioned to rejoice and be glad in it. We are grateful that you have brought us through another week, that you brought us through another day, another minute, another hour, that we can truly come into this place just to praise and magnify your name. God, there are so many things that we can bring before you today. But before we start naming things and asking you for anything, we just want to first create a space just to tell you thank you. Thank you for your love, for your grace, your peace, and your mercy. Thank you for your kindness, your long-suffering, your understanding, and all of the gifts that you give to us. Thank you for making ways that out of no ways, when even those ways seemed insurmountable. Thank you for healing and blessing us in ways that we can't even recount. Because God, it's truly, when we look back over our lives, we can truly say that it's down through the years, God, you've been good to us. You've been better to us than we have even been to our own selves. And so God, we are eternally grateful just for all that you have done for us. And now, as we are making this space and this time just to come before you with requests, we want to first, God, just say, be in our midst today. Because your word has declared when two or three are gathered in your name, Lord, you're certainly in the midst. And we know that when you are present in our midst, great, mighty, miraculous things can and will take place. And so we are lifting up those who are certainly needing the prayers of the saints today. We're lifting up Sharon's granddaughter as she is encountering a very serious health challenge. God, we know that it's by your stripes that we are healed. And so today, as a collective body of believers, we just speak healing to her granddaughter. We lift her up before you and put her in your hands. Because honestly, that's the best place to be. And for those who also just need a healing touch today, whether they are near or far, God, you're the God that's everywhere. And you can touch us in any place. And so whoever needs healing near and far today, we just proclaim that they can receive their healing from you. And while they are waiting for the manifestation of that healing, we pray that you would build up their faith, that they can trust you and love you and serve you all the more. Because they can rest assured knowing he that shall come, he will come. And God, when you come, you are bringing blessings with you. And so we're grateful just to be counted in the number of believers that can be recipients of all that you are doing. God, while some people may not need a physical healing today, maybe they need an emotional healing. I'm praying that even in this season, as we are recognizing your death, God, that those who have lost loved ones in this season, God, that they can truly look to you, look to the hills from whence cometh all of their healing. The help doesn't come from people per se. The help doesn't come from substances per se. God, their help, it comes from you. And so we thank you for being present in their lives when they are needing to cry and cry out, Lord. We know that you can be there as a good father and pick them up and do what you need to do. God, we're thanking you for our community. We're thanking you that you have divinely placed us here on Barnes Bridge Road. And we pray that as we are beginning to get out and spread and proclaim your truth, that a revival would first sweep through this church. I pray that you would shake up the fallow grounds that we even sit on even now. And that you would ignite a fire in our hearts, in our foot, in our hands, and certainly in our minds. That we can first be partakers of what you are doing now. And then we proclaim that as we have been ignited, Lord, we will walk outside of these doors and we will preach to the east, the north, the west, and the south of your goodness. We will tell those that we serve not only a crucified Savior, but God, you got up from that grave too. And so help us to be those catalysts of change and transformation, that people can truly be touched and changed because they've had an encounter with us and ultimately with you. And lastly, God, we are thanking you for everyone in this room. Lord, only you know exactly what they are encountering in this moment. And I pray even now, whatever is concerning your children, that you would solve it and you will handle it. And that they will have a testimony that God has done it again. Lord, let that be our portion today, that you have done it again, that you have blessed again, that you have healed again, that you have delivered again. Lord, let that be our testimony that you have done it again. And we thank you in advance. We won't be people who have to see a manifestation of a miracle, but we will be people who will open up our mouths and celebrate you today. We'll be people that can say, thank you, Lord. We'll be people that can say hallelujah to your name. We'll be people that will shout to the rooftops that we serve a God that can do the impossible. We serve that kind of God. That kind of God that opens doors that can't shut. We serve the kind of God that heals when doctors say it's over. We serve the kind of God that can give a miracle in a dry land. We serve a good, good God. Hallelujah to your name. We serve a good, good God. And we thank you and praise you today. We praise you for what is to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, please stand once more if you are able. Join us in worship. Remember your palms, please. You can wave them, whatever the Spirit moves you to do.
Worship.
the other my salvation. You'll conquer the
Father, we thank you for this time and this opportunity that we have to join our hearts with your holy word. We pray that even now that you would empower us, encourage us by what we shall hear today to be who you have designed for us to be before the very foundation of this world. I pray that we can truly be transformed people because we've had an opportunity to spend time in your word today. God, I pray that the word that we shall hear today, the words of life, I pray that you would move us forward, edify us, and you be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, today our sermon will be coming from the Gospel of Matthew, the 21st chapter and the 9th through 11th verses. In your Bibles or on your screens, you'll find these words. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." I feel like it's been a million years since I've been up here preaching. Some of y'all might feel the same because each week you're like, "Are you preaching today?" And I said, "No, just hold on. Just hold on. We're gonna get back up there." And so now today I feel like it's my first Sunday all over again. Well, that's all right, because I believe that God has something special for us today. The title of our sermon today is "Let the Praise Begin." Working in the realm of HR has taught me a few things. It's taught me the importance of creating a work environment that is conducive for professional growth. This professional growth not only benefits the employees, but also the company. Through job responsibilities, it's our job as leaders of the organization to help foster an environment that fuels purpose, passion, innovation, and creativity. We are tasked with creating an equitable workforce, a place where people can gather and develop a sense of belonging and identity as they seek to live out their professional and career aspirations. It's our job as leaders to ensure that they stay on target and meet their goals, both professional and personal, so that they can become a well-rounded individual, because it helps them and certainly helps our bottom line as an employer. Give me 1 second. Hold on. I gotta prop this bad boy up. I told you it's been a while since I preached. In the church, things are a little bit different. A good number of people assume that the church is the same way. They assume the church's responsibility is to spark passion, innovation, and creativity in themselves. They expect the church to be a place where they can take from so that they can grow and mature in whatever sphere or capacity of life that they need to grow in. While the church has an element of growth, creativity, and innovation to it, the purpose of the church is to serve as a vehicle where believers can gather and mature together. Rick Warren, in his book, Purpose Driven Church, suggests that the purpose of the church is this: for worship, fellowship, discipleship, ministry, and mission. In other words, people of faith, the church is less what we can get, but more of what we can give. What I'm saying is the church should not solely be perceived as a place where you take from, whether it's worship or word, but it's a place that you give time, talent, and resources. Our collective gathering, people of faith, is an indication of what happens in our personal time with Jesus. Today, it seemed as if somebody has been praying this week because of the amount of the edification that we have felt in worship today. Did y'all feel that today? It felt really good in here today. Yes. And that's because somebody has spent time with Jesus this week. Someone has spent time praying and maybe even fasting or in meditation with Jesus this week. And when we come together, it is a manifestation of what we do when we're not together. And so it's important that we take time to spend time with Jesus, because time with Jesus is time that will always be well spent. I believe, church, that our one-on-one time with Jesus tells us how much we love him, how much we appreciate him, how much we worship him, how much we praise him, how much we adore him, and how much we thank him just simply for being Jesus. See, this past week, in the last couple of weeks, I had to change my perception of Jesus. I had to change my perception of Jesus, not only just thanking him for what he can do and what he has done, but I started really thanking Jesus for simply being Jesus. See, I don't want to just thank Jesus because he can open a door for me. No, I don't want to just thank Jesus because he can bless me. I don't want to just thank Jesus because he can do for me what I can do for myself, what I can't do for myself. No, I just want to start thanking him because he's just good all by himself. That he died a selfless death because he had me in mind. We have to start thanking Jesus just for being Jesus. See, what we experience from God is great, but sometimes we just gotta take a step back and reflect on the nature of who God is. Take a step to reflect on God as good because it's in his nature to be good. And so because it's in his nature to be good, I just have to start thanking him and loving him and appreciating him and adoring him because this is who he is. And not only, church, and this is the good part right here. My grandmother used to say it gets gooder and gooder. The good part here is it's not only in his nature, but it never changes. See, the goodness of God, we can take that to the bank as a note that we can cash in on it at any time because his goodness never changes. And actually, let me take that back. His goodness does change. Let me tell you how it changed. It gets gooder and gooder. Y'all weren't expecting that one, but that's all right. See, God is like good aged wine. Anybody like wine here? It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. All right, I got some honest people in here. All right, all right. Anybody else? Okay, maybe y'all like tequila. Right now, we're not talking about tequila. We're not talking about vodka. We're talking about wine. Wine in and of itself, the older it is, the better it is. So the more God keeps being good, the better he is at being good. And that's for our benefit, that his goodness just improves as time continues to go on, that he gets gooder and gooder. There's a couple points I want to make to us today, and I'll be out of your hair. I haven't preached in a while, so I don't think there's any games today, so we got a little bit of time. It's Palm Sunday. It's Palm Sunday. We got a little bit of time. Y'all not rushing to go anywhere but to the board meeting at the church. Yep, that's all right. I know y'all got family that's visiting today, but y'all got a board meeting today. So Mary Alice, Larry, Brian, and Jackie, I know y'all got family. I appreciate the family for coming, but we got to handle some business today after church. The first point that I want to talk about today is that it is important that we must create an atmosphere for God to be good. Why do I say that? When I was considering leaving Michigan, I knew Texas was the place that I wanted to live. I traveled to Texas about 6 times and visited about 15 states at the time, and so I had a pretty good indication on where I planned on ending up, and that was Texas. I did my research on the wonderful state of Texas. You know, when I was in Michigan, I was told that it was cheaper to be in Texas. They said, you get more bang, yeah, I laughed too. They said, you get more bang for your buck in Texas. And I said, well, let's do it. So I get here, and I researched the job market. I researched the housing market. I researched car insurance. I looked at everything, and I felt confident in my decision to move to Texas. But church, there was one thing that I forgot to research, and that was Texas weather. The one thing I did not consider thinking about was Texas weather. Nobody told me how crazy the weather patterns were in Texas. But they did tell me that if you don't like the weather, just wait 5 minutes. And boy, were they true to their word. I waited 5 minutes and everything changes. Church, my first month in Texas, my very first month in Texas, I experienced a tornado. Yeah, coming from Michigan, there weren't many tornadoes. The last tornado, which was actually like a year or two ago, but prior to that, it's like 1997, okay? The last tornado we experienced. And so this tornado that I experienced, not only did I experience it, but it was a mile from my apartment building. So it was real close. So y'all know what I did. I phoned back home to Chanel, which is my mother, and I said, girl, I am in this tub. I'm in this tub. I was crying. I said, Jesus, please, please, please don't let this tornado take me out of here. Because I still got to get married and have 10 kids. Okay. I call that double grace. You know, 5 is the number for grace. So if I get double grace, we're all right. I said, Lord, please don't let this thing take me out. What made matters worse is that my first apartment was on the 3rd floor. Child, see, I thought that if you move up, it's a little better because on the 1st floor, you get to get rid of all the bugs. They're not coming into your apartment and all that stuff. But I realized that Texas is in reverse. You want to stay on that bottom level because with these apartments, there was nowhere for me to go but up. And so I said, Lord, if it is possible, please let this cup pass from me. That's Bible, y'all. That's Jesus on the cross. We'll talk about that next week. All right. That's all right. I don't want to get too ahead of myself, all right? But I'm grateful that it passed. And so, church, since tornadoes are a common thing here, I felt that it was necessary that I did some research on how a tornado forms. A tornado is formed because inside thunderclouds, warm, humid air rises while cool air falls to the ground along with rain or hail. These conditions can cause spinning air currents inside of the cloud. Although the spinning currents start out horizontal, they turn vertical and drop down from the cloud, which then becomes the tornado. In other words, it takes the right atmosphere to cause and form a tornado. Church, I believe today that sometimes we need some tornadoes in our own personal life. And I know you're like, wait, no, we don't need a tornado. No. I think it's imperative for us sometimes to have some tornadoes in our life. Sometimes we hold on to things that cloud our judgment, that cloud our atmosphere, that it is hard for God to get in and do what he needs to be done in our life because we are holding on to it. I believe that God can do any and everything, but I also believe that God does it according to our willingness to submit to him. I believe, church, our lives operate like a hand. See, when a hand is open, anything can come into it and anything can go out of it. But a lot of people don't have open hands, church. They have what I like to call closed fist. So God can't get into it, and you can't get out of it. That's good right there. God can't get in it, and you can't get out of it. The only way for him to get in it is if you open up your heart to him. And this is why these tornadoes are necessary, because they move around all the things that's in its path and in its way. And after it has settled, you can rebuild. And I believe that God is in the business of rebuilding us today. He has torn apart all of the fallow ground in our lives, and now he wants to rebuild so that we can move forward with momentum and with passion. In church, it is time that we allow God to come in to do what he wants to do. And key word is what he wants to do. Not what you want him to do or what you want to do. Those are two different ones. Y'all got that? What you want to do and then what you want him to do. No, we have to allow God to do what he wants to do. Because ultimately, when we submit to him, we are telling him that he knows what's best for our lives. And so we have to open up our hearts to him today, church, so that we can create that right atmosphere for that tornado. Second point I want to make today, and I'm almost done, is let what you know about Jesus change how you feel about him. In our focal text today, Jesus is making his triumphant entry into Jerusalem. People are celebrating him because of the miracles he's performed and the countless lives he has touched and transformed. Unlike other heroic leaders in his time who arrived with an entourage of chariots and soldiers, Jesus fulfilled the words of the prophet Zechariah. Your king is coming to you, righteous and having salvation in him, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, on the foal of a donkey. This was the ultimate sign that Jesus was the true Messiah. This was an unmistakable and irrefutable claim to his kingship in Jerusalem. His intentional actions of riding to Jerusalem on a colt not only affirmed his messianic royalty, but his humility as well. Church, Jesus is riding through Jerusalem as the King of Peace, and the crowd is going crazy. They celebrated Jesus, they praised him, and they joined in welcoming him into their hearts. Tony Evans says it like this: when the crowd saw him, they spread tree branches and their clothes for his mount to walk on and shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David." They weren't merely acknowledging who his great-grandfather was, they recognized this preacher from Nazareth as the Messiah, as the promised King. Church, my question to you today, as we are waving these palms in the air, do you recognize who Jesus is? Do you recognize this prophet from Nazareth in Galilee? Do you recognize who Jesus is? Not recognizing him for the miracles that he's performed for you, but do you recognize and unequivocally can state, "I know who they're talking about, because I have witnessed him face to face." My favorite hymn says, "And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his home." Well, I've recognized who Jesus was. Church, they celebrated Jesus because they had an encounter with Jesus. They were excited about this Jesus. They knew who this Jesus was, whether it was what they've heard or what they've experienced. Church, God does not want us on the outskirts of our relationship with him, but God calls us inwardly to participate in truly getting to know him, so that we could be like those people who can shout Hosanna in the highest. I don't know about y'all. Can y'all practice that? I know the last couple of weeks, we've had some pretty good preachers here. Yeah, they've been good. And Dr. Rochelle Carr, I know she almost had me shouting. I don't know if y'all saw. She was up here like, that's a good place to say amen. She said, say it right there. And she was up here blowing y'all away. I said, woo, yes, that's what I'm talking about. And so since they have opened the door for us to have a, what I like to call a talk back church, we're going to practice that again today. So we're going to shout Hosanna in the highest. Y'all ready? I didn't hear anything.
Yeah.
Okay, there we go. There we go. I just want to make sure y'all still breathing. I'm going to just do a pulse check real quick. I'm going to just check a few of y'all, make sure y'all are okay. You're breathing in. I'm not a nurse if you can't tell. I'm not going to touch it, so just point me to the faucet. I got a jump right there. I got to get somebody that's a little older. So y'all ready?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. Hosanna in the highest. Here we go. Hosanna in the highest. Doesn't that feel good?
Yeah.
See, I believe when we call God by his name, things begin to happen. See, when I call Bandit at home, Bandit stops what he's doing, and he will freeze, or he'll come to me because I call. That's my chihuahua for those who are visiting. He will stop. And he'll freeze, or he'll come to me, right? Or if Bandit is doing something he's not supposed to do, and I call him by his name, yeah, he'll freeze and run to his safe place, the cage. But Bandit doesn't know his daddy is everywhere. So I could be on the couch right here, and Bandit is trying to eat the blinds. And I say, hey, Bandit, and then he'll run over to his cage. Or I could be sitting here and just call him because I'm bored and say, Bandit, and he'll come to me. In every circumstance, church, I can call Bandit, and Bandit will stop and come because I called him by his name. Whether that is me sitting on the couch, or whether that's me going to his cage to get him out, to give him some discipline, and you can take that as you will, I can go wherever he is. Church, God does the same thing for us. It does not matter where we are. God can go where we are.
Amen.
God can find you in any place. And no matter what you need at that moment, God can give it to you. Because God has made you. He has developed you. He has matured you. He knows you. And so God can call you, and when he calls you, you have to stop what you are doing, and you got to come to him. It doesn't matter if you were doing something you weren't supposed to, or if you were doing something you were supposed to. When he calls you, you stop what you're doing, and you go to him. Because he knows you. He has formed you. He has grown you, matured you. He is yours. And you are his. And that gives you a right to shout Hosanna in the highest. Because in the highest is the highest form. See, if we go back through their history, they were attributing his messianic Judaism with him in the person. So they went back and said, oh, we can trace you through the line of David. We can trace you to Abraham. We can trace you all the way to the beginning. And that's why we celebrate you. Because you have come as a person of who we ultimately are, God. God identifies with you in every space in your life. And he is calling you upward. Amen?
Amen.
Last point, and I'm out of here. Last and favorite. The vacation didn't be good, all right? Couldn't tell. Those days on the beach did me well, all right? The last point I want to make and we can shout and get on out of here, is get stirred. When I was in, it was middle school, all of us used to walk around and we used to go up to each other and say, get some. I don't know why we said that. Don't know what it meant, but we just walk up to each other and say, get some, right? And just walk away after that. This last point, it requires something from you. And the last point is, get stirred. See, church, in my daily prayer, every day, every morning, every night, I say this. Father, today, refill me with the joys of today. Help me not to live off the fuel from yesterday, but fill me with the joy of now. See, that's important because scripture tells us that his mercies are new every morning. And so some of us are riding on the mercies from last year instead of recognizing that his mercies are new every single morning. And so every day we wake up, in order for us to get stirred, one, we call him by his name. Then we ask him, Father, refill me and fuel me with the joys of today. Whatever you want me to experience today, help me to experience it today. Because I want more of you today. Verse 10 tells us, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred. Church, that's it. I can close the Bible on this one. The whole city was stirred. They called him by his name because they recognized and knew they needed renewal and revival. They recognized and knew that the only person that could give them the rest, the renewal, the replenishment, the revival was Jesus. And Jesus was now in their midst. So they threw whatever they had. They threw the palms on the ground, threw the clothes on the ground, because they were waiting for this renewal and revival. Church, when they saw Jesus, they recognized at that moment that their prayers were now manifested. They recognized at that moment that this was the one who would give them what they needed in an instant. And church, I come to tell you today, that Jesus is the one that can give you what you need in an instant. That when you call him by his name, he stops like Bandit and say, who called me? Who called? Now I gotta go to that voice. Because, oh, this is real good and I'm done. The reason he comes to you is because he recognized that voice. Bandit knows our voices. So, Chastity had a little girl's night the other weekend, okay? And Bandit was on the fritz, okay? I told you he's a chihuahua, so that lets you know everything you need to know. That boy's a chihuahua in every sense of the word. He barks for no reason. He whines for no reason. He just is for no reason, okay? He does what he wants to do when he wants to do it. So she has all of these friends over, and he is just losing it. Why? He didn't know them. See, God doesn't do that to us. When he knows us, he recognizes us, and he's able to come to us because as I opened up, we've created that space of intimacy with him. Church, it's easier for us, and don't tell me I'm wrong because I know I'm not. It's easy for us to do for the people we do know than the people we don't know. Am I right? Okay. All right. It's easy for you to give to your children because they're your kids versus giving to your sister's kids. You still love them, but you know your kids more. And so you're obliged to give to them more because you know them. Church, God wants to know us inside and out, and he does. But he wants us to come to him so that we can become intimate with him and walk with him, talk with him, learn of him, and do as he has done. Church, I'm crazy enough to believe that what we read in scripture, the miracles that he has performed, those things, they're not what I call past tense. Those things is just giving us an indication of he did it before and it could happen again. And it happens because we are in relationship with him. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. We call upon him today. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand. We've heard the word of God today that has encouraged us. For us to let praise begin in us, get stirred, create an atmosphere, let what we know about Jesus change our lives so that ultimately we can become true followers of Christ. The reason I love the name of our denomination so much is because it reminds us of this timeless truth that God has called each of us to be a disciple. This wasn't just meant for the 12 and then the bonus one and the one that was twice removed. That was a joke. It's all right. I still love y'all. That was meant for all of us to walk in relationship with him. If you're here today, he says, Pastor Brandon, I've heard the word that you've preached today, and I am encouraged. But I don't have a relationship with Christ. I want to invite you to get and start a relationship with Christ. What we have heard today, our relationship only gets gooder and gooder. We grow and we grow. We mature and we mature so that we can be what he's designed. So if that's you and you don't have the relationship with Christ, you have never repented of your sins, and you say, I want to develop that relationship, I extend this invitation to you. Maybe the person that says, you know, Brandon, I have that relationship with him. I just don't belong to a local church home. Well, I want to let you know that we got some empty seats here, which means we are always hiring for new church members. Now, it's a free job. I want you to know. I know I said hired, but it's a free job. But we are always accepting new family members. We're not the chosen frozen, and I won't name what denomination says that. We are the body of Christ, and we invite you to join. Maybe you're the person that says, you know, I don't have a relationship and I want it, or I have a relationship and I need to join a church. Maybe you don't find yourself in either one of those. Maybe you say, you know what, I just haven't been in a long time. I just haven't been to church for whatever reason, and maybe it's time for me to rededicate my heart back to Jesus. This is for you too. So if you say, I'm not saved, I don't have a personal relationship with Christ, I am saved, I just don't belong to a church home, or it's been a long time since I have walked through any door and I need to rededicate that back to Jesus, I invite you to come today. So if that's you, I invite you to come. Let your feet do the walking before your mind does the talking. We invite you to come. Won't you come? Well, hallelujah. Well, that's all right. The Bible says in heaven, the angels rejoice over the conversion of one soul. So that means, that's right, Mary Alice, go ahead and start the clap. Ready. Will there be another? Is there another today that you say, hey, sometimes all it takes is just one person to break the ice. Will there be another? We got two. All right, there we go. Anybody, I'll stay here as long as we need to. This is the most important time of our service. Who else? Anybody else? This is for you. That's all right. Come on down. Yes, yes, the price is right. That's it. Anybody else? This is feeling good to me today. This is how you begin a holy week. Anybody else? All right. Can I have my elders surround these beautiful ladies here? All elders. Because you care for me in such a space. that you'll wait. That's why I'll praise you. I lift you up and I magnify your name. They're still coming, they're still coming. That's why my heart is filled with praise. Amen. While we are gathered here today, I want to highlight that we have two individuals who have decided that they want to join our family of faith. We have Cheryl and we have Chastity here that would love to join us here at CVC2.
Amen.
And so I'm going to ask you both a simple question, two questions that I ask. Have you, in and of yourselves, repented of your sin and have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
That's what I'd love to hear. And then two, very simple question. As a member of our church, will you commit to the best of your ability to support the strategic programming, whether that is financial or through service, and the mission of Casa View Christian Church?
Yes.
All right, that's it.
Amen.
Well, I want to be the first to welcome Cheryl and Chastity to Casa View Christian Church. God bless you and welcome. I got to tell you something. Only I can do that one. It's a poor frog that can't croak over his own pond. I'm sorry. Another one wants to join us too. What an overstate. You get a membership. You get a membership. You get a membership. We all get membership. I'm going to ask you the same question. I'm going to talk through you. Name?
Orai.
Okay. Have you repented of your sins and accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Amen. Do you, to the best of your ability, promise and commit to support the mission of Casa View Christian Church? It's too much. I can break it up. We're going to say yes.
Yes.
All right. Ooh, Rebecca. All right, here we go. And I'm going to pray for you. I won't pray anymore. Okay. Join together as people of faith surrounded as a great cloud of witnesses.
support her and bring her back to life. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 We've had church today. Amen. Y'all can go back to your seats. Uh-oh. That's right. I love the palm. Now wait on palm. Well, we just got a few more things we got to do. And we will get out of y'all's hair.
Y'all won't be able to sit. I'm like, I can't look out.
At this time, I just feel good in my soul today. The Lord is doing something in our midst today, and I'm glad that we are here to partake and witness it. Aren't you glad you joined, Sebastian? And TT, Aiska. She knows her name. As long as she knows it, that's all that matters. But I'm so grateful for you joining us today as well. I don't know about y'all, but I am glad that God visited us today.
Amen.
Amen. The worship team can't even sing right now because God is doing something. And I believe that we're going to experience more of this as we continue to move forward in grace. At this time, it's a time where we all have an opportunity to give to God. Some of us can't sing eloquently, and that's okay. There's a place for you in what we call the congregation. Some of us can't preach and play like our wonderful team. But there's something that each and every one of us can do. And that is to give a portion back to God what He has given us. I believe church, I grew up in a church where they preached what I like to call the 10% rule. That preach that you give God 10% of everything that you give. And while I understand the thought that it came from, I also realize it was very legalistic. I no longer give through a 10% rule. I give because I love God. And I give because I want to see the mission of our church go far. So I no longer put a dollar cap on what I want to give to God because God has given me everything. And so I want to encourage us today as well. Don't put a dollar cap on what you can give to God. Give to God however you feel compelled, because that shows how much you love God and what is doable with your ability, all right? So we have three different ways. We have Casa View Christian Church. You can go to CasaViewChristianChurch.com and you can follow the Givings tab and give that way. We also have our Venmo app. You might be the person that says, you know what, Pastor? I don't have cash today. Rats, I can't give. I'm like, that's fine. We've got our website and we got Venmo. Everybody got Venmo. It's linked to your bank account. Everybody got Venmo. And then for our old-fashioned saints that wants to give, we have offering receptacles on both sides of our stage here that you're able to place your donations in as you receive communion. Church, I wasn't here last week, so y'all know. Did y'all do it last week?
Oh, yeah.
All right. I cut off after the sermon because I had to get back to the beach. So I didn't see what y'all did. But for our visitors today, I want to let y'all know we are so excited when it's time to give. Ain't that right, y'all?
Right. Yeah.
So no, let's show them how we do it real good now. That's great. You better wave that palm here. No matter how you give, in whatever capacity that you give, I just want you to remember this one thing, that God loves a what?
A cheerful giver.
Y'all did it so good, I ain't gotta do it again. Can y'all tell it to our Spanish speaking people back there that God loves a cheerful giver? Did y'all tell them? I want them to know this, what we love giving to God. You can give to your spouse and your partner, but it's nothing like giving to God. Nothing like it. All right, let me sit down, because I'll be up here all day. Y'all know me. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this moment and this opportunity that we have to give into your kingdom. We pray that even now that you would use these gifts that your people are giving to further your kingdom right here at Casa View Christian Church. I pray that these donations will be used to touch our community and continue to impact them with the gospel message of Jesus, that they too can receive salvation. And I pray that you would bless those who are giving, some 30, some 60, and some 100-fold. And for those who don't necessarily have to give it today, I pray that you will empower them so that the next time they will be able to partake in this blessed sacrificial worship. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
This is the Lord's table, and everyone who has come here today is welcome to share in communion. We come from the back to the front, break off a piece of bread or take a piece of bread, dip it in the cup, and return to your seat. If you like the sanitary method, we have these little cups available to you. If you're unable to come forward, someone will serve you in your seat. This is Holy Week, and the things that happen at this table happen this week. On Passover Thursday, Jesus met for his last meal in the upper room with his friends. And when the meal was over, he took a loaf of bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them and said, "This is my body, which will be broken for you." And then he took the cup. And again, he gave thanks and praise, and he gave it to them and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood, which will be shed for you and for all men for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you will proclaim my death until I come again." Jesus gave this sacrifice for all of us. You are all welcome. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Your vision vamos a orar en español por favor. Padre nuestro que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre. Venga a nosotros tu reino, hágase tu voluntad en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día, perdona nuestras ofensas, como también nosotros perdonamos a los que nos ofenden. No dejes caer en la tentación, y líbranos del mal, porque tuyo es el reino, el poder y la gloria por los siglos. Amén.
Please feel free to join us in song as you make your way up to communion, and continue in song of us once you return to your seats.
I surrender all. Okay, now for the announcements. Today, after worship, we have a board meeting. And just so you know, everybody's invited to the board meeting. Also tomorrow at 6 p.m. for those that are that help do data entry for the Catholic Charities, Rigoberto will be here to kind of refresh us on the data entry procedures. On Tuesday, the 26th, is our food pantry from 1:30 to 3. And then on Easter Sunday, which is next Sunday, we're having an outdoor service starting with a breakfast at 9 and followed with our worship service at 10.
All right. I just looked at the weather. It's looking like 80 degrees next Sunday. But again, for now, I don't want you to think I lied to you. But at present, it is looking like 80 degrees next week, which means it'll be great for us to be outside and worship. All right. I think that's all that I had. All right. Well, let us stand. Again, we'll have a board meeting right after worship. We'll only be just about 4 hours. All right. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for the truth of your word and for reminding us that you are Hosanna in the highest. Throughout this week, help us to call your name and develop an intimate relationship with you. And now may the love, grace, peace, and fellowship of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide upon us now, henceforth, and forevermore.
All right, y'all. I know the program says we're ending with Lord, I Lift Your Name on High, but I think I hear the Lord telling me to end with Mighty to Save. Are y'all good with that? I know y'all know the words. Let's sing it out.